Welcome to the first in a new video series I'm calling With One Stencil, where I'll show you creative options using a single stencil. We're beginning today with my wonky houses design. I'll show you how to create mixed media versions of the houses and how to create this four-panel display piece to attach them to. This project began with me creating these houses from the Wonky Houses stencil. I knew that I could use them in a journal page or I could make a card with them, but I wanted to do something a little bit more, perhaps a little bit more elaborate, so that I could create a display piece from them. I really am very fond of these shapes, I love the colors, and I wanted to really do something with it. So that's what we're going to start with, is the houses, and the first place to begin is with your paper. So let me move these out of the way. And these 6x6 pads that are made by a variety of companies. These happen to be from My Mind's Eye. You can see that they're available in lots of different colorways, and they each have a lot of different papers in them, and more often than not, they are printed on both sides. So what happens is you end up with a group of papers that are color coordinated, and you get a lot of different colors and a lot of different imagery to choose from. So I've pulled some out of this little book, and I'm going to start with any one of these houses. Now, you can either use the masks, or you can use the stencil itself when you're doing this. One of the things that's kind of fun to do is, let's see which one I want to use, is to use the stencil, because then you can kind of preview what the house might look like when it's cut from that particular paper. I mean, obviously you can see through the Mylar, so you can see if you place this on, but I like the fact that I don't actually have to look through the Mylar to do that. So this might work. Let's see. This might work. Really, any of these would work, but it's fun. I really enjoyed sort of playing around and seeing what I can do. What do we got here? Let's see this. Maybe I'll use this text. I think I like this one. So I'm going to choose to make this house, and even though the roof is going to be a different paper, what I always do is cut the entire piece out. That way I have a base to layer the other pieces over. When I do this, I like to choose a mechanical pencil with a pretty fine lead in it, and there's a couple of reasons, and I like to make certain that it's a hard lead. First of all, if it's a hard lead, it's not going to smudge. If it's a really fine one like this, and usually 0.5 is a good size, you're going to get a nice crisp line that you can see enough to cut, but it's easy to erase if you don't cut perfectly on the line, and it's really enough to see when you're cutting out. So, you know, the less the better as far as I'm concerned. Now, you can see that my pencil is stopping and starting. That's because with these tabbed pieces here, which is what these stencils are, they're tab cut. See that little piece right there? I did not trim that out. And so consequently, it gets in the way of the pencil. So what you need to do is just come in with your scissors, and you need good scissors to do this. You need something with a decent point. Now I've got a much less rough piece there. If it really aggravates me, I can come in with some sandpaper and smooth that down, and now I know the pencil is going to go along that edge without any problem. And you probably want to do this to all of your pieces, because it gets to be really, really aggravating when this happens. So with this all cut out, excuse me, with this all traced, I'm now just going to come in and cut this out. I'm actually just going to rough cut this out of the paper. Sometimes it's easier to just work with a smaller piece of paper. Now this is just dark enough that I can see what I'm doing. For the roof line, initially I'm going to cut it out exactly on the lines that I drew, but you're going to see that afterward I'm going to come back and I'm going to trim the roof off, or trim it about probably a quarter of an inch off each edge. What that's going to do is allow me to have a guide to place the second piece of paper that will be my roof, but it will do it in such a way that, let me just see where I am here, that I don't have to worry about cutting the roof out of the whatever the final paper is perfectly. What I can do is have that guideline, but it'll make sense when I show you in 1 second. I like this magic rub eraser. It erases without smudging. I never get anything left behind, so it's kind of the one that I use. And I just, actually, you know what, I don't even need to worry about the roof line. I just generally go around the edges of the house. It would help if I'd actually trimmed the entire roof line. So I'm left with this piece now, and the next thing I need to think about is a roof for it. This would work, but I want to have something that's contrasting. And since this group of papers tends to be on the pink and the brown side, I want to do something that's dark enough. Now I think this is probably going to make a really nice roof. This would probably work too. There's one of the dark background here. Where is it? Ah, this one. You know what? This is kind of a damask pattern. I like this. So what I'm going to do is now I'm actually going to bring in the mask. And all I want to do is just trace this so that I have the shape of the roof. Now, obviously, because of the mask, I can't draw all the way across. So all I'll do, and the edge of your stencil works really well for this, all I'm going to do is just connect these two so that I have a roof line. And then I'm going to cut this out. Now, the process is identical for all of these houses. So what you'll do is you'll cut your houses and your roofs, and then you can think about doors and windows and embellishments. And here's where it really gets to be fun, is when we start adding all of those elements. I've been quite busy the last little bit cutting out more houses and getting some windows and doors ready to go too. This is actually a really simple process. I'm just going to move these houses kind of out of the way for now. And I'm going to bring back this one, which is what we've been working on right along. The roof we already done. I've done a window. I want to just show you how simple this is to go ahead and do the door. This is where the masks come in really handy, because you have the openings for the doors and the windows. You can use what I've drawn, or you can just come in and, you know, quickly sketch your own. It's really up to you. If you think that the door or the window should be larger or smaller, it's easy enough to do that too. Now, I named this stencil, or this skinny mini mask, I named it Wonky Houses because everything is wonky. Doors are not straight, windows are not straight, but I think that that's part of the charm of this whole project. So I'm just going to erase the lines. And let me bring this in and see how this looks. Well, first of all, there's a lot of lines left on there that I still need to erase. Okay. I'm actually going to cover that in 1 second anyway. Now you can see that this actually is a pretty small door. It's up to you. On this, if you look at the mask, you can see that there's actually another row of windows. I'm choosing not to put them in there at this point. I can always change my mind later. Now one of the things, and let me just bring in one of these other ones from my original group. One of the things that I've done, you can see that the edges of this house look a little bit grungy. That was really deliberate. This one is actually a little bit more pronounced. This was really deliberate on my part. I wanted to create something that looked aged. It looked a little bit vintage. Even though these are not necessarily, you know, vintage colors per se, you can tone them down by doing what I'm going to show you next, which is to bring in some distress ink. And I'm using pumice stone. I have a piece of cut and dry foam, and I'm doing this to all of my pieces, primarily because I want to tone the colors down a little bit, but in addition to that, I think that having them all with this same kind of look and feel provides some uniformity and some continuity, and I think that it makes it goes a long way toward making everything appear as though it's a unified group. So I'm just going to rub this on here a little bit, and I'm just going to lightly rub the edges, and you can obviously do this as much or as little as you want. That's just a matter of preference. In fact, if you don't want to do it at all, then you certainly don't have to. And I'm actually, when I do these, even though these are little elements, this is probably not going to show on here. I'll do it just in case. But I'm doing this on all the elements, again, because I want to sort of create that unified look. Now, on the dark ones, it's really not going to show, but it certainly does make a difference on the others. One, I'm going to turn this toward me because there's just no way I'll do it right facing the other way. When I assemble these, again, I'm perhaps the worst gluer on the planet. So what I try to do is use something that I get in less trouble with. And before I actually assemble this, I want to talk 1 minute about this roof line, but I want to bring in the glue that I'm going to use. This is what I use when I have to actually glue. For the most part, when I'm putting paper on paper, this is what I use. It's just easier for me to get in less trouble with. So let's come back to this roof line for a second. Earlier I mentioned that initially when I cut this piece out, I cut it out exactly to match the stencil. And then what I did, let me just bring this piece back. If I lay this on here, let's do it this way. You can see that the roof is now considerably smaller. Let's see if I can turn that so you can see it. The roof is smaller than the original piece. I've done that deliberately so that when I lay the roof over the top of this, I don't have to worry about the roof that I cut out of a separate piece of paper actually covering everything. Because I made the roof on this smaller, it's pretty much a no-brainer that it's going to fit. You can see that when I line this up, there's ample room, so I don't have to worry about concealing the original roof line. All I'm going to do is bring in some of this. Ooh, that's interesting. No, I think I'll go with the original one. Get a little bit distracted. See what I mean about me and glue? It just is never a good thing. I don't know what my problem is, but it is a significant problem. There's no question about that. So you don't need much of this glue. I'm just going to put a little bit on here. I do want to get some up in the top so that I'm certain that everything adheres, bearing in mind that the piece that it's adhering to is a little bit smaller than this piece, so I don't need to worry about getting it exactly on the edge. And then all I'm going to do, this is a fairly quick stick, if you will, so once I put this on here, I'm not going to have a lot of opportunity to change it, so I want to be certain that I'm happy with it. Now I'm working on a nonstick crap. Well, there you go. I'm going to have to do something to cover that. Let me wipe my fingers off. I'm working on a nonstick craft sheet, so I know if I get glue on here, it really doesn't make any difference. All I need to do is come in and wipe it up. Now, this glue will dry clear, but it will probably dry with a little bit of shine on it, and so to avoid that being shiny, I might end up having to put some sort of a little embellishment on there. But in the meantime, let's come back and just put a little bit of glue, and that is way too much. Get rid of some of the excess. I'm just going to put some glue on the back of the window. Now, you can use the mask as a guide if you want when you're doing this, or you can just play. It really doesn't make any difference. At the end of the day, houses have roofs, they have windows, and they have doors. Where you choose to put yours is really a matter of taste. Again, same thing. Just going to kind of put that door here. Now, here comes the fun part. So I've got this, and I like this. It's looking pretty good. But what I have found, let's get this out of the way before an accident happens with the glue. It's the way my day's going. One of the things that I've found, and let me bring in, well, what did I do with them? Here's my samples that I showed you a moment ago. And you can see that what I've done is this is the pit, this is the S-tip. I found that the fine, which is what I normally work with, was too heavy for this. But you can see that I've outlined all of these elements, and I think it helps really make a difference when you look at these houses. I think it really establishes the edges, it gives your eye a place to go, and I think it makes them look far nicer. Now, you would think that it wouldn't even show on this roof, but it certainly does. I mean, it's not as though this is a really light colored roof, but it certainly does show, so it provides, again, that line that defines the edge of the piece. And you'll notice that I am not straight. Again, these are wonky. So a lot of times what I'll do is I'll deliberately, and I'm going to do this on the lighter area so you can see this, I'll deliberately draw on here, and I'll do this so that I get multiple lines. I don't want this to be perfect. Again, these are wonky houses, so I'm kind of doing fun things like this with it. Now, you can draw around the window. Let's see. You can draw on the window itself. I'm trying to see if I have one around here that I've drawn around the window, and I'll be darned if I can find one. So since this is so dark, and I know it's not going to show a ton, what I'm going to do is just draw around this window. I think that this is a really nice look. Now, you can go around once if you want. You can go around multiple times. I'm going to put a little knob on this door, and I think on this one, I'm just going to come around like this. And I find this sort of wonky look to be really charming. So you get your houses and you've gotten them to this point now, and you've got, obviously there's a lot more to go, but I want to show you this one next. This is a two-part house, and if I could dig out the stencil for it. Well, you know what, I'll come back in a second. Let me get myself organized, and I want to tell you how you can put this together so that even though this piece of paper is on top of this piece of paper because this was the entire house, there's a way to shade this, and there's a way to work with the colors so that you get the appearance that this little piece is actually behind this larger piece of the house. So we'll talk about that in a second, and again, we'll come back and we'll do all this outlining thing because I think that that really makes a difference. Rather than just being a rectangle or a square, this house was meant to look like it has a little addition on the side. And when you cut this out of paper, there are some things that you can do that help create the illusion of depth. So the first thing I want to do, before I even get there, is I want to think about, let me see, if you look at this house, You can see that there's some spattering of color on here, and that was deliberate. Some of these papers that you buy, you know, all of these wonderful scrapbooking papers, they have very much distressed elements, whether it's, it looks like there's a brush stroke or there's a spatter, but we're going to create some here because there aren't any for the most part on this paper. So this is my diluted version of ground coffee, and I have some funky fuchsia, and all I'm going to do is lightly spritz on here. I don't want a full spray. That's all I want, is little spritzes like this. Now this you're not even going to see because it's going to be under here, but you're going to get this other nice business going on. So now I'm going to come back with just a hint of pink. That's all I want. And if I think that this is too bright, one of the things that I can do is I can just come in and blot, and that will help lighten this. So now I've gotten, let me just sort of place these things, where am I here? Place these things back so you kind of see what we're looking at. So now I've got some far more interesting things to look at because I have some texture and some pattern on this house. And I think that this is fun. And once we start drawing all the lines and everything, it'll really look better. Let me bring this back in for a moment. If you look at this piece that I've cut from paper, you can see that it is the outline of here. But when it comes time to cut the pieces to match up, whether you're talking the roof line or you're talking this little addition on the side, you need some guidance. And so what I did was I just came back with a Pitt pen and I imagined if I drew a straight line that was square with the bottom of this house, I drew it up here, I knew it was going to meet in this corner. So that was going to give me what I needed for the little addition on the side. And with the roof line, I kind of did the same thing. I knew that the roof ended here, so I just kind of came across, and again, I imagined where the roof would go. Now, what I've done, even though this has been trimmed, I cut this just a smidge wider because I know that it needs to be overlapped by the little addition on the side. I don't want to try to butt these. I don't know that I could have done it perfectly enough, so I decided to go this route. So this is kind of what I'm going to end up with, and this is actually what I need to do first, is get this glued in place, then I can get the addition glued in place, then we'll put the other pieces in, and I'll show you how you can make this look like it's actually sitting behind the front of the house. So I'm going to turn it toward me, and again, I want to make certain that I know exactly where I'm going with this. I just want to visually see what I'm doing. Now, the one thing that I know also is that I have a little V here, if you will. So that's going to be formed where the roof line meets the side of this little addition. So I'm going to play around until I have that in approximately the right place. And then what I'm going to do, let's see, this looks like it's way off. Just bear with me one sec, because I don't want to steer you wrong. Okay, so this looks about right now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a little bit of a mark with my pencil right here, because nobody's going to see this, and I'm going to do kind of this, and I can always erase that if I need to. This means that now I'm going to line this up right here, and that's going to enable me to get that in the right place so that when it comes time to glue this in place, everything's where it should be. So again, I'm going to bring back my quick dry adhesive here, and I'm just going to put a little bit on here. Hopefully I won't be making a giant mess. Alright, just enough to kind of hold that in place. Alright, I'm going to use that little area that I made as my guide. I'm going to set the roof in line, and I'm going to press it down. Now I can look at the back to see where I am, and that actually looks pretty good. Let me grab a piece of paper towel. Okay, so that roof is now down. I'm just going to wipe that off. Now I want to come in and put my little addition on. Okay, that looks good. So now what I'm going to do is just get some glue on the back here. I want to pay particular attention to this long side because I don't want there to be a gap here, so I want to be certain that there's enough adhesive right there. Okay. Now, what I want to do is line up the bottom of the addition, this little addition, with the bottom of the piece that I've got on here. Again, I don't have a lot of time because this is quick dry, but I can get this in place. Just wipe that up, and that looks pretty good. Clean the glue up. Now, before I go any further, one of the things that I want to do is bring in my pumice stone, and I want to go ahead and darken these edges a little bit. Now, on this house, the roof, and let me bring back in my original sample. This is all one piece of paper. I deliberately kept this simple because I wanted the focus to be on the front, and that's basically what I've done here. So I am going to just add some color along all the edges here. And I'll come along and do it on this lighter piece as well. That looks fine. Now, let's talk a little bit about depth perception. Typically, darker colors recede and lighter colors come forward. And the way that I can really push this little addition, which is a darker value than the house itself, the way that I can push this to the back is to emphasize this line here, and I'm going to do this with a charcoal pencil. All I'm going to do, and I'm doing this on the addition, I'm not doing it on the lighter piece, all I'm going to do is lightly draw along this edge, and then I'm going to come in and I'm going to smudge. And if I think that that's not enough, I can come back and I can do it again. I try to do this in layers, and I'll do it a little bit at a time so that I don't get too dark all of a sudden and then find myself unhappy with the results or feeling like I need to try to fix a mistake. So I think it's useful to do this a little bit at a time like this. Now I want to just add a little bit of color out here too. Again, I want to create the illusion that there's a shadow falling on this little addition being thrown by this edge of the house. Ultimately, what you end up with is a piece that looks like this. And even though this piece of pink is sitting on top of this lighter striped fabric, it definitely looks like it's behind. So then it's just a question of coming in and adding the other elements, getting them in place, doing the outlining the way that I did on the other sample a moment ago, and then it's time to talk about the really fun part, which is embellishing these. Here comes the fun stuff. We're going to start embellishing. I'm going to begin with something that's really simple and straightforward. You'll notice that some of the houses, when you look at the mask, they have these little circular windows in the roof. So all you can do is lay your mask on top of your piece. And then what I generally do is use my Pitt pen, and I'm just going to trace in the circle. Now, obviously, that's going to give me a pretty close to perfect circle, which I probably don't necessarily want. So I can come back and I can change that perfect circle to something far less than perfect. Let's get these out of the way. And then what I can do is bring in my charcoal pencil, and I can just lightly sketch on the inside of that line. And then I can smudge it, and that's going to give me the illusion of some depth in that window. That's one thing that you can do. Brads are another thing that you can do. Lots of companies make brads now. You can see this is probably a good size one. This is probably 3/8 of an inch. Brads used to be small and hardly decorative, and now they've become much larger in many cases, and they're very decorative. So they have two legs. I've already clipped one off. Just lift the leg out of the way, clip it with these wire cutters, and if you have an end sticking up, you can just kind of push it in. Now, to glue this in place, what I would typically do would be to use something like the Aliens, the super thick tacky glue. It's going to work on multiple surfaces, so I've got something that's non-porous, and I've got obviously the paper, which is porous, so I need to use an adhesive that's going to work on both of those surfaces. Let's just get this turned over. And I kind of need to fill in the back here with the glue so that there's enough to actually touch the paper. This is a clock, so I want to get it oriented the right way. That looks about right like that. So I'm just going to set it in place, press it down, and give that ample time to dry. So that's something that you can do. In addition to that, part of Tim's ideology line, and let me see where I've got them hidden here, are the mirrored stars. These are not just for Christmas. You can kind of place these anywhere. There's lots of different sizes in the packages. If I wanted to put one here, I could do that. Let's see, where are my houses? These are my first set, and somewhere in here, you can see I just use a star here. Very effective. Again, I would use the tacky glue because you've got a non-porous to a porous surface. Here's another example of using just, this is kind of a plain brad, but again, you get that same kind of look. So the stars are an option. In addition to that, we have some Venice lace I'm going to talk about in a moment, but there's all kinds of other ideology bits. There are things like these lock and keys. There's a variety of different things that you can use. There are, if you want to go with a little steampunk look, you can go with some of the gears. There's the plaquettes. There's the word bands. And you can do fun things like this. You can take some rayon seam binding and you can color it to coordinate with your houses. And I'm going to show you that in 1 second, because I'm going to show you how I color the seam binding and how I color the Venice lace. One of the things that you need to bear in mind is if you are putting together a house, let me just bring all the components in. If you're putting together a house like this one that's going to have some trim at the roof line, I like to bury the sort of unfinished edge of the Venice lace underneath the roof line. So what I would do would be to glue this in place, and then I will glue my roof in place. And what I, once I know that this is centered and it's all set, then I would come back and I would just, from the back side of this, I would trim this off. So there's a way to use Venice lace, which works out really well. I think this is a really fun look. So let me just break away for 1 second and show you how I actually go ahead and I color Venice lace and I color rayon seam binding. So this is a piece that I did a little bit earlier. This is Funky Fuchsia and Ground Coffee. And I like these colors. I think they work kind of, whoops, help if I bring that in. They work really well with this group of papers. So let me show you how easy this is. I generally like to wet all this first. I find that the color doesn't grab quite so readily. It doesn't give you really dark areas where the color sort of just attaches itself. The good news is that neither dilutions or color wash, if you don't heat set it, are permanent. So you can always take this to the table, excuse me, to the sink, and you can wash the color off if you've got something that you don't like. You have to do it right away because otherwise you're liable to get some staining. But color wash is only permanent once it's heat set. So again, I'm going to bring in my watered down version of Ground Coffee and Funky Fuchsia. I'm just going to mist lightly. I'm going to kind of scooch these around. Let me bring in some of the Funky Fuchsia now. I don't want too much. I don't want this to be too bright. All right, and I can see that I need to get some more color in here. This is the back side. Nope, that's the back side. So what I'll do is come back with a little bit, whoops, a little bit more Funky Fuchsia, and I can just kind of run that through there. Now, the good news is if I think that's too bright, I can rinse it out by just putting some water on it from my spray bottle. The other thing that I can do, let me grab a clean paper towel. Let me grab two clean paper towels. Let me just mop this up for 1 second. This is definitely too late. These colors are going to lighten when they dry, so I am going to come back with a little bit more of the Funky Fuchsia here. Try to move my stuff. And a little bit there. And I'm going to come back with some Ground Coffee because I want to tone this down a little bit. Alright, so here's what happens. Before I dry this, I'll take this in a piece of paper towel and I'll squeeze it and squeeze out the excess. And that gives me this lighter version. Now again, if I think that this is too light, and in the case of the seam binding, it definitely is. Sometimes you just have to experiment and play a little bit till you end up with something that you're satisfied with. And I like this. This becomes far more mottled this way, so I would consider that done. I would generally dry that with a heat tool. I would hold it with my scissors and just go ahead and dry it. I think I'm going to put just a little bit more Ground Coffee on here just to tone that down a little bit. And again, I would normally bring in the heat tool and dry this, but I really don't need to do that right now. So what else can we do? Once you get your rayon seam binding dry, and you can crinkle it like this before you dry, and that will give you this nice wrinkled look. But once you get this dry, you can attach it to a plaquette like this. If I could find the word band, you can certainly do the same thing to one of the word bands. It's really easy. Rather than make yourself crazy fiddling around with this, use a toothpick. It makes life a lot simpler to poke that through. And then you just run your seam binding through like this. You can tie this, you can glue this, whatever you find that you need to do. You can trim these on an angle, kind of like what I've done here. And then what you do is you can place it on something like this. Now obviously this needs to be one of the larger houses in order to not overwhelm the piece. And I would probably trim this if I were going to put this on here. But you can see in the one that I did earlier how effective this is. I really like the way that this looks. Now you'll notice on here Chit Chat stickers. That's something else I want to bring in. If I could find them. Where did I put them? Here they are. All right, so Chit Chat stickers. Let's just bring in this little house. These are available in a seasonal group as well as just a regular group of sort of everyday sayings. And some of them are meant to be put together as a sentence, but some of them really do stand alone. For example, if I take this word family and I put this in here, if I could get it lined up properly, I can just go ahead. Again, these are wonky houses, so if it's not perfect, that's okay too. Just go ahead and press that in place, and I think that that's just so effective. I could do the same thing here if I wanted. Some of these are far longer, like the word forevermore, so it would fit really nicely in one of, that's a little bit too far into the wonky, I think I need to move that just a little bit. That would fit really nicely in this larger window. Let me bring in my samples here. You don't have to put them in a window. You can put them off separately by themselves, and then you can just sort of draw around them. Lots of different ways. Trimming. This is, actually, let me come back to this. The Chit Chat stickers are available in the craft color and in this white color. For the both of the projects that I've been working on, I've been using the craft. Obviously, they're identical. What's available in the white is available in the craft, so you can certainly use those too. Trimmings. This is the group of trimmings, and you can see that I've cut a piece of this rickrack to fit. This would be really effective on any of these houses. I think that even though it's black and, you know, we're using kind of the browns and the pinks, I think it works really well. I think it works equally well on my green and my turquoise group. This is another group of trimmings. This is called, let me think what this is called. Industrious border stickers, that's what they're called. How wonderful is this? When you look at these, you have fun arrows, you have several different kinds of borders, and what I was thinking that I would do, again, I would kind of want to center this, I would put this on here right like this. Now, I would probably use some of the Aileen's Tacky Glue on the back just because these are kind of embossed and I want to make certain that I get a good seal on this. But I think once this is trimmed off, this looks really, really nice. I love the look of these stickers on here. You could take an arrow. Let me see if I can push one out here. You can take an arrow and you can do this. How cool is that? I really like that. I think that this adds a really, really nice touch. Now the last embellishment that I want to show you are, let's move all of this out of the way, are these little pink hearts. This one doesn't have one, but it will eventually. Someplace here is my other house. I have no idea where it's landed, but nevertheless, I'm going to show you how simple these are to make out of a little piece of paper clay, and then we'll color them, and we're going to put some distress glitter on them, and I think that these are a perfect embellishment for these houses. Hearts, house, home, I think it all goes together, and you'll notice that by using the same color across all these houses, you'll see how this becomes a unifying element. It really pulls all of these different houses together. I think these hearts really make this project. I love the pop of color, I like the symbolism of the heart with the houses, and I like the fact that there's one, or there will be one, on each of them. I'm going to put one on here, and I'm going to show you how to do that. But I like the fact that it adds a unifying effect because all of the houses are pulled together by those pink hearts. Let me show you how super easy this is to do. This one is not glued on. I'm going to hold that to one side to show you in one second. I'm going to only work with a little tiny piece of creative paper clay, and I'm hoping that my dirty fingers aren't going to translate too much here, although it really doesn't matter because I'm going to color these before I put the glitter on them. So all I want to do, I actually find it easier, rather than trying to pick this off of a work surface, I find it easier to just press this on a piece of paper. Then you can pick the paper up and bend the paper away. Now these are not going to be perfectly flat, but it helps if you make them as flat as possible. It means that they'll sit more firmly on the house, they won't be wobbly, and it means that there's less sanding that you have to do. So that looks pretty good. All I'm going to do, this is just your standard run-of-the-mill X-Acto knife. All I'm going to do is cut a little heart out of here. Now, everybody has their own way of making hearts. I like to kind of exaggerate the lobes a little bit here for these that go on the houses. So I'm kind of making the lobes stand up a little bit off the heart. Don't worry about that raggedy edge. It really doesn't matter. Sanding cures a multitude of sins, as it were. So all I'm going to do is just gently use the knife to cut the heart out of the paper clay. Now you'll notice that this is not uniform. One side is bigger than the other, meaning the lobes one side is bigger than the other. I don't care. Now what I would do would be to come back and I would squish this all together and I could make another layer out of it. I'm not going to do it. For the sake of what we're doing here, you don't need to see me do that. But what I do want to show you is what I do next. I'm going to put just a little bit of water here. I'm going to use this, or if I could put my hands on a palette knife, I'll use, well, this is a giant palette knife, but still. All I'm going to do is use a little bit of water on my finger to kind of pat the edges to smooth them down. Again, whatever you take care of now is less that you have to do once this is dry. And this is really thin and it's winter time, so it won't take long for this to dry. And if you find that you have a rough edge, just go ahead and smooth it. But by the time you get through putting the glitter on here, it's really not going to make that much of a difference. Now everybody's fingers are too big to fit in that tiny little section between the two hearts. So you can either use your palette knife, if you have one, or you can carefully, because obviously this is sharp, but you can come in with your X-Acto knife and you can do the same thing so that you get a nice clean separation between the two lobes. Put this to one side. I actually make a bunch of them when I make them, so go ahead and put them to one side, and then once they are dry, you have pieces that look like this. So I've made several of these. Now you can see again that they're not all the same shape. They're far from perfect, but that's okay because again, we have wonky houses. We don't need perfect hearts. So this one has actually already had a little bit of work done to it. This is really fine sandpaper. I want to say it's 280 grit. Let me work on this one because this actually needs some sanding. All I do is lightly, you can either sand on the piece or you can run your piece on the sandpaper, whatever you find yourself more comfortable with. I generally do both. And all I want to do is just come in here. It's easier to go with the cut edge when you're trying to get in here so that you're not trying to squeeze a fold in between the two lobes of the heart. You can just gently shape this so that your lobes are defined. And then, as much as I try, the backs typically are not perfect, so just lay this down and go ahead and sand it. Paper clay is really soft once it's dry, and so this will smooth out pretty well. Just kind of get rid of that sanding dust. I can kind of do the same thing here, but again, this is all going to get buried under some glitter, so it's not going to really make any difference. These are not ready to color, but I am going to just bring in. This is Funky Fuchsia. I'm only using it because it's close in color. I want to get all of the edges and this all done. I want to cover that white, and what that's going to do is, if I am not perfect when I apply the glitter, if there's a little bit of a bare spot, you're not going to know it because the color underneath is so close to the color of the glitter. So I'm going to just take 1 second and come in with my heat tool and just dry this a little bit. While I'm doing that, I'm going to grab the glitter and another piece of paper towel, and I'm going to use the tacky glue. I want this to mound a little bit. That's enough. That's really all that needs. So what I'm going to do, now the nice thing about Tim's Distress Glitter is that while it is sparkly, it's not that ultra shiny, ultra fine, super duper glimmery glitter. This is a lot more subdued, and I really like it for this project. That's way too much glue. This is a messy project, especially for someone who is so glue challenged like I am. All I want to do is spread this out, but again, the whole point of coloring the heart is that if I just miss slightly with the glitter, with the glue, it's not going to make any difference. Now this is going to want to stick to my fingers, but I'm going to place that sticky side down in the glue. I'm going to find my tweezers. I'm just going to push that so I know that everything's come into contact. There it is. It got buried there, so that it's all come into contact. Now, unfortunately, let me just do this. The tweezers just bumped that glue a little bit, so I'm going to come back. I'll flatten it out, fill it in, and then I have this little heart. So this is really easy, but like I said, I find it to be very effective. I like the way this looks. Now, you can put hearts any place on your houses. I have some on the roofs. I have some on the bodies of the houses. Put them wherever you like this, wherever you think that they work, but put them, because I think that they really are a wonderful component to these houses. If you want to use your houses on journal pages or perhaps on a card, then you've pretty much got all the information you need to do that. You can follow all of the instructions and all the things that we've done and make your houses that way. If you want to go a step further and use your houses to create a display piece like I did, then stick with me. That's what I'm going to show you how to do. And I'm going to begin with these pieces that you see here. This is 140-pound watercolor paper, and I've cut it to 6 inches by 8 inches. Now, for my piece, I'm using 4 panels, and this is the original group of houses that I started with this kind of green and turquoise theme. And you can see that my backgrounds are done in blues, but I'm going to do that even though I'm using these pink and these browns. I think the blues are perfect for pretty much any color combination. Regardless of the color of the house, I think this makes a nice background. So I'm going to show you with the blues that I used, and I'm going to show you how to do this. So I have a piece of watercolor paper, if I could get my fingers on it, all pre-cut here. And what I'm going to do is bring in my mop brush and 4 colors of distress paint. I have faded jeans, peacock feathers, tumble glass, and shaded lilac. I'm going to make sure these bottles are all shook, and then I'm going to put a little bit of color out on my craft sheet. Now, I know I'm probably going to use tumble glass the most, so that's what I'm going to use the most of. I'm only going to use a hint of the shaded lilac, so I don't need to put a ton of that out. That's probably enough. Now, I'm only going to do one here for you, but when I do these, typically I'll do all of them at once. That way, they all really look the same. Sort of how I apply paint might vary from day to day, and by doing them all at once, it helps ensure that they all have the same look and feel. So with my colors out, what I want to do next is put some water on here. And you'll notice that there are edges, defined edges, on each of these panels. You can see that there's one here, and there obviously are here. The way that you achieve those defined edges is to outline them with water. So what I'm going to do is take my spray bottle, and I'm going to put a good-sized puddle of water down. I'm going to need a fair amount of water. This is a 1-inch mop brush, and it works really well for this. Anybody who's done watercoloring knows that you use a mop brush to apply washes of color onto your watercolor paper, and you can do various techniques with them, from backgrounds to sort of all other kinds of things. Now, what I want to do is apply water on this in this kind of ambiguous random pattern that gives me these kind of flowy edges, but they're going to be defined edges. So it might be a little bit hard. I'm going to tip the paper when I get this on here so that you can actually see what I've done. But I'm going to start in the middle by just laying a wash of water out here. And now I'm going to bring it out to the corners, and I'm just going to kind of wave this around. When I say wave, I don't mean like hello wave. I mean I'm going to create wavy lines around the perimeter of the watercolor paper. Just turn this way. I actually need the light to reflect so I can see what I'm doing too. Wherever there's water, there's going to be color. Now you can see that there's a little bit of fiber that's come off my brush, and there's actually a piece of picked raspberry distress glitter that's gotten picked up. This will all come off later, so don't worry about it. Don't mess with it right now. Let me just go ahead and tip this. And I can see the reflection in the light in the camera, and I know that you can see that as well. Now you can see what happens here. The water puddles along this edge. There's a property of the water, I believe this is called the meniscus, And it actually stops the water from just traveling. If you break that meniscus, that surface tension, then the water will flow. But because there's not enough pressure to do that, the water pretty much stays in place. So I want to be certain I have enough water on here because it's going to be important to get the distress paint to move this way. I don't want to flood it. I don't want to overdo it. And I would suggest that you practice and play with this a little bit so you get some sense of how this works. So now what I'm going to do is, making certain that I have water on my brush, I'm going to come in and I'm going to pick up just a little bit of the tumble glass. And I'm going to start laying the color in. And you can see what happens. It starts to wick up. The water picks it up and moves it. It's actually going to do part of the work for you. I generally do this just a little bit at a time. I just want to kind of scooch the color in place. And I'm pretty much going to put the tumble glass over the entire piece, which is why I put more of that out on my craft sheet. This is my primary color. So again, I'm just going to gently come along and apply the color all around, and I'm going to turn the card this way, or turn the paper this way. I'm going to apply this color and I'm just going to gently move it around. I'm also going to let the water do part of the work so that the color wicks. I'm never going to approximate that particularly well. If I let the water do its own thing, then it's going to really do a lot of the work for me. And once I'm satisfied with this, then I'm going to start bringing in other colors. Now I'm going to add a touch of the peacock feathers because I want that color to be deeper in some places. So I'm just going to come in and I'm going to lay the peacock feathers in there. Now if you think that it's not moving enough and you're not satisfied, tip the paper and you'll see that, and I need to turn this toward me, and you'll see that it starts to move. Now I broke the meniscus, the surface tension right there. So I'm going to grab a piece of paper towel. This is light enough that I can recover from this, but I need to dry this so that the color doesn't continue to flow down into that area right there. All right, so let's come back to picking up the peacock feathers, because again, I want to get some of that color in other places. I want this to be very soft and delicate, but I do want there to be some color on here. And if I think that this is too much, now I don't have a bowl or a container with water. If I did, then it would be a little bit easier to clean this up. But what I can do is just come back, and now this brush has mostly just plain water in it. I can come in and I can put this water in and I can start breaking up this peacock feathers if I think it's a little bit too much. I actually don't mind this. I think it's fine. It becomes, like all things, it becomes a matter of taste and preference. So now I'm going to pick up a little bit of the faded jeans, and I just want to touch this color here and there. I want to add a little bit of deeper color. And eventually I'm going to do the same thing with the shaded lilac. I put just a little bit of that in various places just to give this some pattern and texture. Let me see if I can turn this way. You can see I get the colors running and moving. I want to be careful. But by doing this, I break up any hard lines, which I like. I don't want there to be hard lines. So now without cleaning the brush, I'm just going to come and I'm going to pick up a little bit of the shaded lilac. And again, I'm just going to touch this in certain places, so that I get a little bit of the purple here and there. And that's probably all I'm going to do to this, other than playing with this a little bit and letting the colors move and run. And some of the time, depending on what happens, you can see I've got this was totally unintentional. I got this kind of burst effect going on here. Sometimes it happens that way. It depends on how the water flows. Sometimes you get a little bit, let's see, I've got this kind of vertical thing going on here, probably because I tipped the paper and then the paper was bowed a little bit. I set it down and the color flowed. This is all very ambiguous. It just kind of happens the way that it happens. If you want to try to create a pattern, you can do that, but I find that I like the look when I just kind of let the color flow the way that it will. Once you get these done and you need one for each of your houses, and again, I'm using four because I have four of those original green and teal houses. Then it's just a question of letting them dry, and then we'll move on to actually applying elements to the various pieces, and eventually we'll take the four of them and we'll put them together with the dowels to make the display piece. When I arrange the elements on the panels, I typically will spend some time auditioning elements and pieces and thinking about what I want to do before I ever put glue on the back of anything and put it in place. And so that's basically what I've done here. Now, one of the nice things about using the distress paint for our background, all of this wash that we just did a moment ago, is that the color's permanent. So I can add all kinds of things on the top, and I don't have to have any concerns about that color lifting or moving, or more importantly, changing what I'm applying. So you can draw foreground elements and little bits of grass like I did here. I've got this little birdhouse. I've certainly done this tree. This sun, I didn't have a paper from one of the pads that I liked that I thought the yellow was working on, so I just took a piece of 90-pound watercolor paper, I spritzed some color on it, let it dry, and then I just cut my sun and my rays out. This is already glued in place, and in keeping with all of the outlining that I did here, again, I want to provide some unity and some continuity, I outlined these elements as well. The tree was just something I drew and then I colored with, again, color wash and dilutions in the detail water brushes. It's something that I do all the time. So I do a lot of playing before I ever put glue down and I settle on what I want to do. These are my scribble flowers. So I'm going to just show you the basics of this. I have a couple of panels here that are more or less laid out. Now I know that I'm going to put this house on this panel and I'm going to put these flowers on here. And because these are both intended to be my ends, because these are busy, I want to keep my center panels, the two between them, I want to keep them a little bit quieter. So all I'm going to do is think about where I want to place some elements. And what I might do is come in with just my pencil, and once I have an idea of where I want to put my house, I might come in and just draw a little bit of a grass line in here so that I kind of know what it is that I want to do, and I know that I'm going to have these two flowers here. So, and these are just my scribble flowers done with distress paint and, you know, jelly roll pens and the Signo Uni pen. So I can just kind of do this so I know what I'm doing, and then I'll come in with my Pitt pen. And so what I want to do is I'm going to just work with what's here, what I started. I don't worry about keeping inside of the colored area of my panels. I'm not concerned about that at all. So I'm just going to play a little bit here. Now I know I want one flower to be taller than the other, so I'm just going to bring a stalk up like this. I'm going to add some leaves, and I kind of have an idea of what's going there, and I can add some grass along here too. And then I want my other flower, maybe I'll put a little bit of bend in that stalk. Again, the same kind of thing with my leaves. And then I know that this is about where this is going, and I can turn this flower until I'm satisfied with the way that it is. So I can come in and I can lay my house back in and think, okay, I like the way that looks. So in order to really establish the foreground, working with the pen and putting these marks in helps, but what really helps is bringing in other color. So I'll bring in, I have lettuce and I have fresh lime in just the detail water brushes, and I'm just going to lay color here as though there were grass and other elements. Some of them are a little bit stalkier than others, but you just play a little bit. Now I have some pencil on here that I know I'm going to have to move, and then I'm just going to paint some color in the stems and the leaves. And then I'll come in with the lettuce, which is just a slightly darker color. You don't have to do this, but I enjoy this sort of painterly look and messing with the colors like this, so I do like to do this some of the time. And these are my watered-down versions of those colors. I'm not using them as they would come straight from the bottle. Once I get this done, then it's just a question of placing this back, making certain that I like it, deciding if I need to put anything else in here. If I wanted to add some other elements, I could, but as I said, I want to leave these two center panels relatively quiet. And then it's just a question of finishing the other panel. This is the other one. Because this is a fairly good size house, it's going to take up quite a lot of room, so I'll put some foreground grass elements in the way you saw me do a moment ago. I'll do the same thing here with my little flower, and then it's a question of punching holes in the panels and attaching them to the wooden dowels. Assembling the panels into the finished piece is actually pretty easy. I'm going to use dowels and rayon seam binding to accomplish that. The dowels are 3/16 inch in diameter, and I've cut them to 10.5 inches long. Once I did that, I sanded them, I put a coat of gesso on as a primer, and then a coat of picket fence distress paint because I wanted everything white. The holes in the panels, and you'll need four in each panel, even the end ones, the holes in the panels are 1/8 inch holes. I used just a straight 1/8 inch hole punch. You're going to measure 2 inches from both the top and the bottom edge and measure in 1/4 inch and punch 4 holes in each of your panels. In terms of dowels, because I have 4 panels, that means I need 5 dowels. There's going to be 1 between each of the panels like this, and then there's going to be 1 on either end. So assembling these is actually pretty straightforward. You're going to start, and I believe, let me just grab the one that I've already got in process. Let me just check this distance. From the top, you're going to come in about 3.5 inches. That's going to allow you to line the seam binding, sorry, up with the holes and still have that piece that extends on the top. And I'm going to bring this piece back in a moment. So what I want to do is come in and I'm going to start by tying my seam binding in just an overhand knot on the dowel. And then I'm just going to measure to make sure I'm in about 3.5 inches. So let's just measure that about like that, and then go ahead and tie this off. And I can slide this to get it where it needs to be, but that's pretty close. I'm just going to push it up a little bit. You're going to do this, you're going to tie the seam binding on both dowels, as you've just seen me do here, and then you can start by flipping a panel over, and this is going to actually go like this. And then what I'm going to do, you can see that if I stand this up, these are the 2 panels as they're going to go together. So I'm going to, from back to front, I'm going to push the seam binding through the punched hole. And using a toothpick actually helps make that process a little bit easier, because otherwise it can be kind of a pain to get that seam binding to feed through. So just go ahead and push it through. And you need to do this for both panels, top and bottom. So again, you're going to push it through. And this is what you want to do. Now when you get this done, it ends up looking, let me move this out of the way, it ends up looking like this. Now this is the front, and you can see that I've got my holes all lined up here, more or less. I've got my seam binding coming through. Now let me give you a measurement. If this one measures about 3.5 inches from the top, this first seam binding tied onto the dowel, the bottom one measures a little bit less, more like 3.25. And you can just kind of play around. It can do this however you want. And there's more than one way to do this. So if you don't like what I'm doing, then by all means, figure out a better method. So once you get the seam binding coming through each of these 4 holes, you're going to turn the piece over. And then you're going to grab the seam binding. All right, let's get that pulled up. Okay, so I want to take the seam binding. Let me turn this toward you. I'm going to take the piece of seam binding, and I'm going to bring it between the dowel and the panel so that it's in the back. I'm going to do the same thing with the one on the other side. I'm only going to do the top piece for now. Once I have these coming through like this, it's just a matter of tying them again in an overhand knot. And I'm not going to pull this up too tight right now because I'm going to probably have to make some adjustments. I'm going to do the same thing on the bottom. I'm going to take the seam binding and I'm going to feed it around between the panel and the dowel on both sides. Again, between the panel and the dowel, and I'm going to flip this over, and I'm going to grab them and tie an overhand knot. Now I want to flip this over and see how it looks, and I can play a little bit to adjust this. Now, will these be perfect? Probably not. Do I care? Definitely not. I'm not really all that worried about it. So I probably would not tie these super tight initially, and if you wanted to do this on the front so that you had little bows on the front, you could do that. I thought this was a little bit cleaner looking, and I kind of preferred it. And so it's really just a question of getting all 4 of the panels together with all of the dowels in between them, getting them tied on here so that you like the way that they look. Now, this is going to stand up, and I need to move this towards you a little bit, and this is not going to slide. But if you feel uncomfortable with this not being glued on, what you can do is once you know exactly where you're going to tie the seam binding, where you're going to attach it to the dowel, just put a dab of glue there very lightly so that it doesn't bleed through the seam binding, or you can do it in the back, and that way you know that your seam binding is not going to slide up and down, although honestly there's enough tension because I've tied that knot tightly enough that it's not going to be a problem anyway. So then it's just a question of going ahead and getting all 4 of the panels, or however many you've made, assembled, and your piece is basically done. Now the back of mine, I didn't do anything to. I'm not really worried about this. If I had thought about this a little bit better, I might have come and put something on here, For now, I'm really not worried about it. Quite frankly, I'm going to look at the front. I'm not going to look at the back, so I don't really care. But I think that this makes a really nice project. And as I said a couple of segments ago, if you don't want to assemble your panels, or if you just like the idea of making the houses, these make, can you imagine this as a card, obviously folded or whatever, but this would make great card material. These houses are just wonderful. Whether you put them in a journal, you make a card with them, or you do what I've done here to make this display piece.